Okay, so let's go back to the formula that we are trying to build throughout this chapter. We're trying to build the formula that we call the weighted average cost of capital, or WACC. Students often call it WACC. It has to reflect some sort of average of the cost of equity, RE, cost of preferred stock, RP, and cost of debt, RD. We have just reviewed the calculation of each of these three costs, and now we need to connect them. So if a firm has all three in its, as we say, capital structure, so it uses money that comes from bonds and preferred stocks and common stocks, then we need to use some sort of average of the cost of equity, cost of preferred stock, and cost of debt. We call it the weighted average. So, should we just sum up the three costs, RE plus RP plus RD, and divide them by three, which will be the simple average of the three, to give us the weighted average cost of capital? Turns out that's generally a wrong approach, because adding the three and dividing by three is the simple average, which means you're implying that the firm has the same dollar amounts of equity, preferred stock, and bonds in its capital structure, because it's the same thing mathematically as 1/3 times the cost of equity, RE, plus 1/3 times the cost of preferred stock, RP, plus 1/3 times the cost of debt, RD. In general, this of course doesn't have to be true. In general, firms may have a lot more money that's borrowed rather than what's sort of provided by the company owners. So, what does the weighted average mean? What would be the correct way of calculating the average of these three costs? We need to multiply each of these three costs, three R's, by its own weight. So the weight of equity in firm's capital structure multiplied by the cost of equity, RE, plus the weight of preferred stock in firm's capital structure multiplied by the cost of preferred stock, RP, plus the weight of debt in firm's capital structure multiplied by the cost of debt, RD. And the key here is these three weights, they don't have to equal, they can be completely different, fractions of the firm's capital structure, firm's value, in other words, but they must add up to 100%. So, how can we calculate firm's capital structure weight? Let's look at that next. The weights are determined by how much money in dollars of each type of financing is used by the firm. So you can imagine this pizza-looking image, which is the value of our firm, and you kind of split this circle into three sectors, and the sizes of the three sectors are not necessarily the same. So one sector is equity, another sector is debt, and the last one is preferred stock. And we need to find the value of these three sections of the firm value. So we say that the market value of a firm, which we denote by V, equals the sum of market values of equity, or E, preferred stock, or P, and debt, D. So V equals E plus P plus D, all in capital letters. What do we mean by market values? It means, so there's actually a difference between market value and book value. So for example, let's look at the first component of this sum, E, capital E, which stands for equity. What would be the market value of equity and what would be the book value of equity? The market value of equity would be equal to the number of shares of stock currently outstanding multiplied by today's price per share. The book value would be equal to the number of shares outstanding multiplied by the price per share when stock was issued originally, maybe a number of years ago. So the market value reflects the market price per share or today's price per share. And that's what really determines, you know, how much a firm is currently worth. Everything is based on current values of everything that comprises the firm value. The same thing can be said about the market value of preferred stock, which is capital letter P in our firm value formula. We need to multiply the number of shares outstanding by today's price per share rather than the price per share when stock was issued, which would be the book value. And for bonds or debt, which we denote by capital D, and that's the third component of the firm value, the market value would be equal to the number of bonds outstanding multiplied by today's price per bond. If you instead multiply by the $1,000 face value, that will give you the book value of bonds. And that's kind of something that's static over time. It doesn't change. Just like the book value of preferred stock and common stock shares. But the market values is something that's not static. It may be changing over time, right? Stock prices fluctuate over time, and so do bond values. So it's the market value of everything that goes into the calculation of the firm value, as well as the weights, that which is our goal. So how do we then apply the market values of the three components of the firm value to calculating the weights? Well, mathematically, we need to divide both sides of our firm value formula by the firm value, by capital D. And then mathematically, we would just have V divided by V on the left-hand side, which is simply 1. And that equals, on the right-hand side, E divided by V, and that's the weight of equity. So some percentage out of 100%. Plus P over V, the weight of preferred stock. Again, it's some percentage out of a total of 100%. Plus D over V, the weight of debt. So 1 on the left-hand side is the same thing as 100%. So the total sort of kind of value of the firm. And the three terms on the right-hand side are capital structure weights, and they must all add up to 100%. So weight of equity, E over V, weight of preferred stock, P over V, and weight of debt, D over V. Three weights in the firm's capital structure. Now let's look at a couple of examples.